Ladies and gents, the two-time New Zealand World Champion, Mr. Bobby George. Take a pew, pal, take a pew. Now look, how many of you are over 170 years of age? If you are, you might remember Bobby. No, I'm kidding. Look, I've got to say, and he knows this for an absolute fact, I was about 10 or 11 years of age, just got into darts. I happened to live around a similar area to which Bobby played, and I happened to be in a club the same time as Bobby was, and I said to my dad, there's Bobby George. I want to play him. I want to play him. And there was loads of dartboards. And my dad kept on and on. The man I now call Bobo, because he's a friend. And I'll tell you what, playing someone like that as a youngster, there's no education. It's one of those, you can't believe the moment you're in. You can't believe it until years later. And I've never probably thanked you for it, Bob, but I'll tell you what, you took time out to play me as a 10, 11-year-old. I want to say thank you, and I've never actually done that.
Well, Wayne was a fucking nuisance, really, to be honest with you. I was playing a club called the Grove Social Club, and his dad used to bring me along because he loved darts. And I used to get loads of guys queuing up to play me. That was me practice. And he'd say, me play. I'd say, fuck off, will you? And his dad used to say, don't you want to play him? I said, let him take the chalks and I'll play him. So I'll play him. Then he'd go, me play. You know. But he turned out a good player, didn't he? Because he practiced with me.
Yeah, that's right. That's the reason. But I'll tell you what I've got to say, Bob. Now, for those of you that... Do you watch just TV in general? Who has ever seen? Look at his shirt, right? Who's ever seen Gone to Pot? Has anyone ever seen it? It is one of the most hilarious things you'll ever watch. But it's educational. It's educational. It is about basically five elder statesmen of the community from all different backgrounds going to America to try marijuana, right? No, it sounds great fun. Don't it, Bob, until you fucking eat it. I'll tell you what, it was hilarious. If ever you've not seen it, get a chance. What Bobby's about to explain about eating, smoking, digesting and everything marijuana, some of it will absolutely blow your mind. It will blow your mind. It's beneficial. It's not beneficial. You shouldn't do it. You should do it. But, Bob, you've experienced the whole lot, mate.
Before I went to America, I was a bit sort of, don't like the drug. Me boys smoke it. I've been around it 40 years. Never tried it. And I went over to America to Gone to Pot, and I had to try all the different bongs, the different strengths. It was lovely. I just fucking loved it. I had 3 weeks of I thought I died. I thought I went to heaven. I had 3 weeks over there and I tried everything. The worst thing you can do, now if you ever, all drugs come from plants. Now there's four most addictive drugs in the world. The first one is nicotine, comes from a plant. Second one is alcohol, comes from a plant. Okay, the third one, most addictive drug in the world, is coffee, comes from a plant. And the fourth one, I wouldn't have got, is aspirin. Nothing to do with marijuana, nothing to do with all the drugs. They're the four most addictive drugs in the world because you can get them. They're legal. Marijuana is not legal, only in CBD form. This is what I smoke. This is legal. It's not Happy Backy. Hello. No, this is CBD. This you can buy in a shop. This is for your eyes and your bone structure, everything. THC can still help you. The government won't allow it, only for like people who've got seizures. I went to this woman's house, it's a true story, and invited for a meal. Because her daughter had an accident, a car accident. She's unfortunate, believe it or not, a plane landed on her car. Now that is unlucky, isn't it? Fucking hell. It was Ryanair. No. I just put that in to make the conversation more interesting. Fucking hell, I'm going to get sued now. Anyway, she said, they have it in a mill and all that. But her daughter had it, and she let her smoke a joint a day, CBD under her tongue and CHD. And she has, instead of 210 seizures a day, she had one. Now, if that works for you, you've got to take it, haven't you? You know, if you've got a loved one that's ill, and you've got no other way, no avenue to go down, you've got to take the marijuana, mate. You've got to smoke it for the pain, everything. I know it's illegal, but fuck it, who cares, anyway. Long as your loved one gets well, true? Anyway, she gave me an ice cream. So I like, every time I have a meal, I like a load of ice cream. Greedy, you know? So she gave me three dobs. I said, nah, go on, chuck another couple on, doll. But she did. I ate it. She gave me 35 times over my limit. Of course, it doesn't affect you straight away. It's 3.5 hours later. It's the most horrendous pain you can have. So whatever you do, you people out here, if you want to try it, do not fucking eat it. It's bad news. It's like 1,000 seasickness and 1,000 hangovers in one session.
You thought you were going to die, didn't you?
I thought I was going to die. The only thing you can do, you can move your fingers and you can spew. And that's true.
So you can move your thumbs?
Thumbs, just your thumbs. And if you open your eyes...
So you're effectively Martin Adams.
My thumbs are more intelligent than that. If you look at any light, you start crying. It's a terrible thing. But I learned a lot from it. It is not the drug that people made out. It's not a bad drug. It does a lot of people good. So I actually tried everything I could while I was over there because I was doing a documentary. I didn't sit on the fence. I got high. It's like four puffs. It's like four pints of lager. In a bong, it's like six pints of lager. You know, fucking lovely. Fucking cheaper than drinking, as it happens. But the worst thing you do is eat it. But the first time I had this was I went to this nunnery and they're dressed as nuns. They look like nuns. So you think, they're fucking nuns, don't you? You know, because your brain thinks, oh, it's religious.
It was a nunnery.
No, it was a marijuana fucking place.
It wasn't a nunnery.
No, it wasn't a nunnery, but they're all dressed like nuns. And they're all growing it and smoking it. And the first time I had it in California, I sat down, it was a nice day, and this Mother Superior said, Bobby, you want a joint? I thought, fucking nuns asked me for a joint. You know, my head couldn't get round it, you know? I said, no. She said, oh, don't be a prat. So I said, all right, and it was, hello. It was a great program. If you haven't seen it, have a look at it. Gaunt the Pot is really funny. Educational. If every drug you do, if you do it respect, it's good for you. If you take the piss, then it ain't. So remember that. Okay? And also, thank you. Also, when I'm talking, I'm myself. If I swear, it's not that I'm rude, it's the way I'm brought up. And if you swear, I used to say to my kids, you can swear indoors, but don't swear outside. Anyone comes up to you and says, look, little boy, try that up your nose, tell them to fuck off. Remember that, kids, won't you?
Sure, yeah. recently, Bobo, you've had another toe taken off. Most people that have anything taken off their body nowadays is something to do with diabetes or the way they live. Your bone structure, because you've worked so hard in your time, has caused you untold problems. Absolutely untold problems.
Well, I used to dig tunnels, believe it or not. I was a tunneler. So I dig tunnels and I lay granite floors. So I've worked hard. And I've mucked my body up doing it, to be honest with you. You know, I've had four toes off. I've got one at home, as it happens. I kept one.
No, that's true. I've seen it.
Yeah. I put it behind my bar in vodka. That's true, because vodka can preserve it. So if I'm away for 3 weeks, my missus can suck me toe while I'm away and she don't get upset.
Hold on.
Hang on.
He calls it. You go around his house, which is like a fucking... It's an absolute palace anyway. He's got a bar that the size of this, and he gets it out. Would you like a cock toe? No, I fucking wouldn't, no.
But I had my toe off about 6 weeks ago, and while I was in there, I got circumcised at the same time.
What, again? Circumcised again? That's a third time.
Yeah, I put it behind my bar. I put it behind my bar in a bucket. So. No, it's just that I wore my body out. I wasn't very clever. I use my physical strength to earn money. And I walk like a monkey sometimes. I can't help it. I went and see the Planet of the Apes, and it's like 2.5-hour movie. And I got up, and my missus with me, and I thought, oh my, I couldn't get up. So I'm like that. And I'm walking out. She said, stand up, Bob. You've taken the piss out of the film. I said, I can't stand up, though. And I got to the foyer and some dickhead threw a fucking net over me. In a Colchester Zoo for the night. I just put that in to make the conversation more interesting, honestly.
Bearing in mind, you've worked that hard. And this is before you built your own house. You've worked that hard. Why did you want to build your own house when... you'd worked so hard previously. Surely you felt, do you know what, let someone else do it. But you wanted it done right, did you?
Well, I built a few houses, but I always wanted lakes. And I found a piece of land with the water level so I could have lakes. I didn't want to build a great big house, but they said you can do a mansion and all that. And I thought I'd do the drawings. So I've done all the drawings. I made it 28 bedrooms. I thought, get on that, you platters, right? Because they always knock you back. And I went to the meeting with my wife, Marie, and it came out on a big screen. They said, it's a bit over the top, but yes, we'd like to see it go up. I thought, oh, shit. Because I had to wait 6 months and put another drawing in. So I made it 18 bedrooms. And people say, why did you make it 18 bedrooms? The reason why, because I like to make love to my wife in a different room every night. If she can fire me, she can fuck me. If she can't, I'm in room fucking 12, I told her. I mean, I overdone it with the bedrooms, but it's... Look, when you've got space, you fill it up. So you build extension, you fill that up. We just fill everything up. So I overdone it with George Hall. Now, I built George Hall. It took me 6 years with the lakes to do it. It's a lot. I was doing the exhibitions and I'm laying the blocks, I'm digger driving, everything.
Was that more or less single-handed, Bob?
Not single-handed, but almost. Yeah. 9 fingers, put it that way. And it's... I never said that before. That's fucking good, wasn't it? That was quick, wasn't it? It was quick, wasn't it? Nine fingers.
That was good.
Thank you. Now, for him to say that, it's got to be good. Anyway, so I built it, and I called it George Hall, because the law says if you don't owe any money on the land, or you haven't got a mortgage or anything, you can call your property what you like if another property is not the same in your sort of like area. So I called it George Hall. And then this woman walked past with her dog, and she said, "Mr. George, can I have a word with you?" I said, "Yeah." She said, "I'm disgusted with you." I looked down, I thought I had my dick hanging out, you know, because, you know, I'm fucking like that. Anyway, I'd love to say this on the BBC, they wouldn't let me. So I said, "What do you mean you're disgusted?" She said, "You know, she called it George Hall. William the Conqueror lived on your land, right there. Geoffrey Mandeville lived there. And also, all kings and queens have been here, and then you call it George Hall." I said, "When I came here, darling, it was a field. There was nothing there. I was going to call it fuck all, but the council wouldn't let me." Got the right arm. Her husband actually laughed.
Now, who is interested in the BDO and PDC? Right, there's a few of you. Bob. The Ollie Croft story.
Oh, yeah.
Ollie Croft, just to put you in the frame, Ollie Croft was the main man behind the British Darts Organisation. He was effectively Barry Hearn of yesterday, right? That's how big he was. Anyway, go on.
Anyway, he used to come to my house with his son and grandchildren, and I've got dogs. I've got six Jack Russells at the moment, but I've always had dogs. I love dogs. And I had a Dulux dog. Doshy's name was, because I named all my dogs after money. One's Dosh, one's Cash, one's Fiver George, one's Euro. I named all after money. Anyway, this one was Dosh.
One's Fake.
Anyway, Ollie, every time Ollie came, now, it had been done so he don't get the odd or nothing, the dog, he didn't, you know. But he used to sniff around Ollie, and Ollie said, "What's he doing?" Because he ain't had a dog, you know. He said, "What's he doing?" I said, "He's fucking you." "Oh, is he? What's his name?" I said, "Barry Hearn." And I put it in the darts world, and he phoned me up. "I want an apology." I said, "Ollie, if you have fun with your opponents or your enemies, it's easier, isn't it? It's a bit of fun."
Yeah.
You got to, ain't you? You got to get on, ain't you? True, isn't it? Well, brilliant. I'll be nice to your next door neighbour when you hate him. Say, "Morning, you fucking prick," under your head, like under, you know. Don't you? Inside you say that, don't you?
Now, we've discovered what Bob did before darts, what he did kind of during darts, if you like, but there's something that happened in April this year where Eric passed away. We know that you've had many dealings with Eric throughout your years, but 1980, when you played him in the World Championship final, that led to a great relationship. It did, but before that, you knew him really well, more than, probably better than anyone. And there was a story that you mentioned to me months and months and months ago where you basically had to take him to a money match. Money match. Now, tell us how that turned out. This is hilarious.
Well, the thing is, in our day, it wasn't there like today. They've got PDC, bid all the tournaments. We had to play money racing. Now, money racing, you play a guy in the area, or I played Leighton Rees, Alan Evans for money, and you get known, and they say, "Oh, would you come to our club?" That's how you get known. Well, Eric phoned me up, and he said, "Look, I've got a money racer at Loughton in the Mother Hubbard pub, 300 quid.
What would this have been, 76, 77?
76, about 76. I mean, he said, "You pick us up, give us a lift." I went, "Yeah, all right." So I picked him up, went to the Mother Hubbard. He played a guy, I remember his name, Bob Wood, his name was. and he absolutely beat Eric up bad. Real bad. He really could, this bloke could play darts, and he beat Eric proper. Eric said, better pay him. I said, pay him? You told me to pick you up. I ain't paying up. I said, how much you got? He said, 300 quid. I said, a lot of money then. I said, I ain't got 300 quid on me. You told me to pick you up and take you home. Oh, we fucking hell, we're going to get our head kicked in. So he said, because it was packed. It was a pub, but with a hall on it. It was packed, all betting. He said, I'll wind them up, he said. So he went, oh, Bob Woods, think you're clever. You got lucky, I'd off day. Beat the big fella, see how good you are. And he said, no. He said, come on, give it all that. Play him, double or nothing. Oh, all right. So I've got to play double or nothing now, haven't I? And it's a lot of pressure on you. We've got no friends. Everyone you saw was not a friend, you know? Anyway, best of three, 3,001. It was 1-1. And on the last 1,000, I was in trouble. I lost it a bit. And he was going 10, I was going 85. He went 60, I went 10. But I wasn't so on the ball. So Eric's there, and I said, Eric, look, there's me keys to the car. Bring the car round there, I said, on that door. And when he hits the double, I run out and you fuck off, right? Because we're going to get our head kicked in. So I went to frame, pulled me, went, I said, what? He said, I can't drive. I went 10-40, 10, 10-80, 10. I played the best 801 ever in my life. Sweating. Eric's frightened out of his life because he thinks he's going to get beaten up. So we played all night for nothing. And that's how we learnt our trade. So you guys out there, put your money where your mouth is. Then you learn.
Yeah, that's what champions are about. And I've spoken to other professionals about the news of the World Championship and the World Championship. And it's a shame that the news of the world stopped, because Bob was the first two-time champion of the news of the world. It was the best of three 501. Now, yeah. Absolutely incredible. And the first time that you won it, Bob, was without dropping a leg. And it's kind of incredible nowadays that it's been forgot about because it stopped. But the importance back in the day, if it was still going today, it would be the equivalent to a world championship. And this is how important it was. Just to reiterate how good this man was, not that I need to keep doing it. Eric Bristow's dad once said to Eric, who'd already won the world title, by the way, you've not won the news of the world, you've won nothing. This man had already won it twice. That's how important it was. That is how special what this man was doing. And he comes up and he's got the sequins on, he's got everything else, and he gets his little nipple out, which we all love. We love that. We absolutely love
that. This is for all the ladies and the hairdressers. I see that, it says, no way, babes. He didn't expect that.
I have spent so... My wife drives me about everywhere because I don't drive, right? I don't drive. I'm fucking useless. She picks up Bobo on the way and we have a great time. And he keeps us highly entertained. But I've got to say, Bobo, you've been around... This is something we've probably not discussed either. You've been around in darts since the mid-70s. Now, the changes that have gone on, good, bad for darts?
Well, I think it's good for the player who's good. When I played, we played from 8 foot. Tiny little trebles and doubles. They play from 7 foot, 9 1/4. They say 2 3/4 inches is not a lot. But you ask your wife. right? Makes a lot of... If I had another 2¾, I wouldn't be fucking sitting up here, to be honest with you. Anyway. And it was like a dull light. The MCs was, yeah, that's it. It was up today. They got bright lights, all the colours. They're looked after. We go to these shows. You get in the big shows, I have two minders to take me to the toilet. That's true. They're not hairdressers. I'm talking about their, you know. And I think, never happened in my day. So I've got two guys beside me, one of them a wee. That ain't too bad. But when I have a dump, they're standing outside the door. So I have to put the paper down the toilet so they can't hear the plops, you know. I thought I'd put there to make you laugh. Anyway, this trust has changed. It's all, they're looked after now. And it's run better. The dartball's nice colours. The coverage is good. It's great for the dart players. Good luck to them. They say they're earning this. When I was playing, I'm happy what I earn. I'm happy what I got. Good luck to them. Let them earn a few quid out of it.
Have you ever got called short?
Oh, he said he murdered this boy. Do you know what?
No, you said
about I have. Look, have you ever been driving down the motorway, right, and you want to dump, right? And you go to a garage and, you go, no toilet. Fucking hell, you think. Go to the next one. And I remember I was going down the motorway and I see Kentucky Fried Chicken. I was right in trouble. So I pulled in, straight in the toilet, boom, trousers down, bang, bang. Oh, lovely. Turn around, no toilet paper. and it was a wet one and all. That's what, you know, when it's, I thought, oh, no. Well, you know, you can't, can you? You thought, no. So I thought, I've got loads of dosh in my pocket, so I pulled...
Did you hear that fella? He shouted, socks! He shouted, socks! Use your socks!
Who said you took it? Oh, you know, I never fucking thought of that. They smelled the same, did they? Anyway, I thought, I'll get a tenner out. You could get a tenner out them days and wipe your bum, couldn't you? You know... And I wiped my bum and I went in, washed it under the tap. Today, well, I did, I thought, I'll give it to fucking John Lowe when I see him. Washed it under the tap. Today, with the modern £10 notes, you wipe your arse, it'll be up your fucking back, won't it? Oh, I've got to tell you, I might be running out of time, but I've got to tell you, John Lowe and me never really got on. Right?
No, hold on. John Lowe and anyone never really got on.
He didn't like me. He didn't like me having the sequins, clowning about, candles. And I was on the plane going to Denmark, and Eric liked to wind. He said, "Read here, Bo, see what's in the sun." I looked at it. John Lowe's formed this professional union. The first thing you're going to do is ban sequins, candles, and clowning about. So I thought... There's no one has sequins and candles on him. I thought I'd pull him. So I walked down the aisle of the plane. I said, "Lobo," he said, "yes." Because he found them teeth in the gutter, you know. That's why he didn't buy them, he found them. "Yes," he said. I said, "What's this? Gonna ban, you know, sequins and candles and clowning about?" "Yes." I said, "Well, if I join, I'm gonna ban wigs and false teeth." He never talked to me for 10 years. I'll go like this in case he's... You do that. The old-fashioned comedians used to do that, didn't they? Because he's listening. John Lowe is the tightest man I've ever met. Ever. He loves shopping, but he goes on a Sunday when the shops are closed with his wife, Karen. And the only shop open was a butcher's. And he's looking in the window, he said, "Oh, see that sheep shed in the window, Karen?" She says, "That's not a sheep shed, John." He said, "I know a sheep shed when I see one." She said, go and ask the butcher. He said, butcher, is it a sheep shed in the window? He said, no, sir, it's a mirror. I got me own back, Lobo. I got me own back.
Right, we've nearly run out of time, but I'm afraid so. There's still more things to do. But Bobo, you have one more tale to tell, and basically you're not from around here, are you?
Okay. Before I go, first of all, I'd like to thank you for being so kind and listening to me. Thanks very much. I must say that. And I would always like to tell a little story every night, so I'm going to tell you this one. I went to my local to have a nice ice cold beer and watch my dart team play and see if they could play better this year. Well, look to me right, I thought, oh, he looks a bit queer. Well, he winked and he grinned, and with no fear, he stuck his finger in my ear. I thought, that's weird. So I went over there. Had another couple of ice cold beers, and for the second time in the afternoon, I turned, and there he was. He winked, he grinned, and with no fear, he stuck his finger in my ear. Well, I thought, that's queer. So I went over there. Had another couple of ice cold beers, and for the third time in the afternoon, I turned, and there he was. He winked, he grinned, and with no fear, he stuck his finger in my ear. I said, look, son, you do that again, I'm going to kick you out the front and rear gear, and then you won't make love for a year. He said, I come from a different planet. I don't come from round here. I've got no front or rear gear. I said, how do you make love then? He said, I'll show you. He winked and he grinned, and with no fear, he stuck his finger in my ear.
Ladies and gents, no other words are needed. Mr. Bobby George!